This is Steph Versteegen.
Sorry.
That's all right. You are going to talk there.
Yes, I'm talking.
Good. All right, Steph is senior keeper at Melbourne Museum, and she spent nearly 7 years at the Amphibian Research Centre breeding crickets and endangered frogs. Steph is going to talk about her frog story, and please welcome Steph. Thank you.
I think he's back.
Sorry. Comes from my background in frog conservation and loving frogs since I was a kid, literally. It's great to have like programs that you're sort of involved in running that, again, people who aren't frog people from that age getting into it, because, you know, there are other people out there, there's some in this room, there's some out of this room, who have been fighting, but the general public also has to be involved, and you know, the new mum and dads with their kids going to the parks, they need to be involved with their kids and being aware of it, even as you said, when no sign is finding their bodies. So yeah, it's really important. Hi. I was pretty excited when I heard about the Frogs Victoria group sort of starting up. I haven't been involved in any frog groups before. Quite young when Jerry's sort of frog group finished up. So I was really happy to get back out into the frog community and sort of basically tell a bit about my story. So my presentation, I'm calling my frog story, as I said. I was at the ARC for nearly 7 years, and I have many big discoveries. I call myself a frog expert. I just really like frogs, and I've done some pretty cool and interesting stuff with some really special frogs, so I just wanted to share that. So one of my first memories, finding a brown tree frog in my grandparents' staghorn, and I was hooked. Hooks, collectibles, I was re-hooked back to front, learning all the scientific names, and I came across the word herpetologist when I was about 10, I reckon. I'm like, yep, I'll be one of those, thank you very much. I think I was told by, you know, when you visit your families, and they're like, oh, she'll grow out of it. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm not growing out of it. I'm like, I think my parents sort of knew that that was going to happen. So in 2006, I did year 10 work experience with the ARC when they were at Werribee, and I still remember walking into this room and seeing some frogs like these. Banana box frog room. So for those of you who don't know, basically frogs come down in bananas and different veggies and that kind of thing, fruits from Queensland. You can't send them back. So different organisations like RSPCA and the zoos collected them, and they ended up at the ARC, and basically got a room full of your white lips, your green tree frogs, your dainties, your dwarf tree frogs. And I just remember standing there going, yeah, I could do this. This is just awesome. So that was really great. I went on to do biological science at uni. Any project I could do, I did on frogs. And then I went knocking on ARC door again when they moved to, this time they were at Peacedale. And needed some work placement, so I did my hours of work placement, and I got some time job out of it, so that was pretty awesome. I then spent my first sort of, for quite a long time, playing with crickets. So for those who don't know, the ARC is funded by basically selling crickets and other insects to pet owners in zoos around the country. So no crickets, no frogs. So although I was there for the frogs, the crickets go hand in hand with them at the ARC, and I learned all about them. I was breeding the colonies, managing the colony, and everything I learned in that cricket room I used with the frogs, and I still use today. I think that was a really important sort of background for me, because crickets have such a long life cycle. You see every single change you make, and especially because we weigh them at the end of the day to sell them, you see that change in weight. So you change the water supply, you change the food supply, you change the heating, you're going to see that. So in a short-lived species, that's really awesome, and it just makes you think about it in everything else you deal with, so especially in the frogs for me. So I'm just going to go through a few bits of the frogs that I've dealt with the most with. So I did spotted tree frogs, Victoria Spencerii, southern primary frogs, superfine rubbery, bulbar frog, Filaria frosty, and a bit of on the alpine tree frog, Victoria berry white, alpina. So the ARC has important backup populations for some of these frogs, all these frogs. And we were actively breeding most of those species for backup populations for some to release into the wild, and others were just sort of holding populations. So these are these frogs, for those who don't know what they look like. So corroboree frogs, spotted tree frog, that was my first male warble frog that we found in the wild. And not a great picture of the alpine tree frog. These are all my photos, they're not great photos, but I'm like, oh, I'll just grab them all and use them all. Why not? So I'm not going to go too far into the projects. There's people in this room, again, out of this room, who are still involved in the projects. I'm not still involved. I'm just going to tell you a little bit about some of the stuff I did, basically. So the most important thing I think to get away with this is, I still remember at ARC we used to get people knocking on the door going, oh, I like frogs, and you throw them into the cricket room for a day, it's 32 degrees, it's high humidity, there's dust everywhere, it smells like crickets. And they're like, oh no, I don't like frogs that much. In saying that, the other side of the frogs is endless hours of just monitoring and feeding. A lot of the photos I'm going to show and talk about are field trips and that. Not like nothing of the work that goes into it. The one day in, you know, sometimes 5-year project is a field trip to sort of release frogs or catch frogs. So really important stuff that we were dealing with all these species, the alpine species. At the ARC, they're housed in shipping containers, literally a metal box. So in summer, you have an electrical problem or an aircon problem, and you suddenly got a lot of problems. So monitoring temperature, massive big deal. Keeping them all their tanks clean and tidy, especially for eggs, tadpoles, and baby frogs, really important. The glory days of releases and field work is awesome, but 99% of the times that was what you were doing. So a spotted tree frog. I did probably the most amount of work with this species. I did raised about five seasons of babies through with these species. They're an alpine frog. They need cold water to breed in. They need highly oxygenated water. They lay their eggs under the rocks in the river systems. And so you basically have to replicate these conditions, which we did. And as you can see, the male calls, the female is like, yeah, okay, as most frog species are, and then they go for a swim and lay their eggs under the rock crevice. We find them literally by looking under the tanks, through the glass bottom tanks, so that was handy. Let them develop and then set them up in the tadpole tanks. Fed them on mainly frozen cosmetics, a little bit of fish flakes, and a little bit of seaweed. They grew legs, and then we set them up in terrariums with automatic watering and fed them. And then depending on what projects were and what they demanded, we then later on, maybe 1 year, maybe 5 years, toe clip them and release them to the wild if they were lucky. If they weren't, they just bulk. They sort of sat in their cushy little environments at the ARC and sort of kept there until they were ready to go back to the wild. So the first release I did with these guys was a Victorian release in 2012. We actually did a media release at Melbourne Museum where I'm now working, which is quite funny, I find. We took them up to Victorian High Country to release them. The release went all out really well, no problems. We got back and I think it was a week later, there was a once in 50 years find. And 200 odd frogs, I think, was decimated. Nothing you could do. Nothing you could sort of, you know, pretend to, you know, preempt on that count. So that was a great start to my releasing, but then it slowly got better. I was then involved in releasing some in Mount Kosciuszko. So the main population of this species is in New South Wales around Kosciuszko. So we literally had the frogs in the polystyrene tubs, taped to our backs. Some were night releases, some were day releases. And these were released on historical sites where the solitary frogs were found. There were still frogs that were carriers of chytrid in this area, which is why the solitary frogs were suffering from chytrid. So they were still sort of coming across and dealing with chytrid and having to drop off if they got chytrid. So that sort of made it quite difficult to deal with. You also couldn't put out a whole heap of frogs because the bigger the population of frogs, the more likely you would get chytrid and they're just completely spread through all of them. So in about 2013, 2014, there was more across the idea of releasing them in an area where they hadn't previously been found in Kosciuszko. So it was part of the, what's it called? The water treatment. What's it called here? I'm trying to say. Kosciuszko.
Snowy.
Thank you. Snowy water scheme. And so there was river system basically created by the Snowy Hydro and I'm probably not getting this exactly right. You're the only one hopefully who knows this. And there were no frogs in that area where we released them. So there's no carriers of chytrid. It was sunnier. This species likes to bask, so it was a really great spot. So they were released in this area and they have survived in this area and I've heard that they've bred in this area also. So that's a really good turnaround. Still a fight to go, but sort of it's great when you can get them back in their environment. So the next species I did a lot of work with was the crockery frog, the southern crockery frog. So here we've got some gorgeous little male moths. And then this is a moss bank that we had at ARC to grow moss for our frogs we had there. And then that's me releasing some eggs, which those eggs were actually from Taronga Zoo in the middle of Kosciuszko, which we flew in by helicopter, which is pretty cool, to say the least. So yeah, that was pretty awesome. So again, these guys are in Kosciuszko. They are a small froglet. I always go in trouble because I call them pathetic because they don't really jump, they fall. So as a frog, you're sort of like, how can you not jump? But that's sort of their body shape, smaller legs. And the male, they live in the moss bogs in Kosciuszko. The males create a nest. They call, the females come and find them. They lay very large eggs, around 16 to 38 eggs per clutch. And then as the area floods, the tadpoles hatch and they sort of are in the water there and hopefully turn into the juvenile werewolves. So, currently, but they're basically extinct in the wild. Last time I heard there was 5 males in the wild. The good news about this crockery frog is there's quite a lot of genetic variation in the holding populations that Taronga, Melbourne Zoo, Hillsville and ARC Hub. There's also, as I said, four different organisations involved in it. So on all these projects, having backup populations super important. So if something goes wrong, God forbid, at one place you've sort of got the backup, you're not going to lose a species because there's a bar in Taronga or whatever is going to happen. So that's sort of super important. So these guys, because they live in the same environment of predator species, which are carriers for chytrid, they don't do great being re-released unless they're in the areas where there aren't any predator, which there's not many of those. So as part of this project, there's been this frogging closure, chytrid exclusion closure, have been made and put up in Kosciuszko. So this is the first one and the largest one, I believe. Basically, it's smack bang in the middle of Kosciuszko. We released a whole heap of quarry frogs there. They're in their natural environment. They're getting just rerouted water from their natural river systems. It's successful. No predators or chytrid, other frogs can get in and they can't get out. So much cheaper, so much less manpower than having a room full of, there could be, 200, 400, 500 frogs in there. If you had a room full of that many frogs, it would be so much harder. You obviously need a lot more room, electricity, watering, all of that jazz. So this was successful, and then they made some smaller ones, obviously, again, cheaper. So just round ones, a little bit of water, sprinkler systems, last I heard that they were breeding in these enclosures. So although they're not actively back in their environment, it's a step, intermediate step forward sort of until we deal with chytrid hopefully one day. The next frog I dealt with, not as much, because that was sort of ARC was getting back into it as I left, was leaving. So, was the bawbaw frog. So we've got here, this is on Mount Bawbaw, sort of a male nest site that you sort of have to dig up. That's the gorgeous habitat, completely untouched, right next to the road or anything like that. Really lovely habitat, and as I said, the bawbaw frog. So it's the only endangered frog to Victoria. It lives only in Mount Bawbaw. So you've already got a frog with a really small range, and then it gets hit with chytrid, and the population has disappeared 98% since the 1980s. So it's completely dropped. They're a really sort of important frog, as you probably heard. Melbourne Zoo are also involved in it. They just recently released that they have not only females, but the females are breeding and have produced a clutch of eggs, exactly. So that was awesome to hear this week. I had someone tell me on Sunday, and I'm like, that's awesome news. So these are metamorphs that we got from the eggs that we were first collected in the wild. And so it was the first project I was involved in sort of from the start. So we were basically designing enclosures for them, designing sort of ways to raise them and keep them sort of thin. So the males basically make the nest. They have a foamy nest that is in the ground and in the mud on the side of Mount Kosciuszko. And the tadpoles are nearly albino and are just amazingly crazy alien looking things that then hatch and slowly come into these tiny metamorphs. They're certainly the smallest metamorphs I've ever dealt with. Finding them as they're coming out was extremely tricky, I remember. It was really awesome. I've got all the odds. I still remember working in there one day.
I wouldn't want to
go. No, that's mine. It doesn't matter. I was working in there one day and I'm suddenly going, what the sound is that? That's a different noise because there's pumps going and there's the aircon going and that. And I realised that some of our males were calling. And that was such a special feeling that, okay, we're getting their morphs through. You know, obviously we're doing something right there, but not only that, our adults are sort of comfortable in how we're housing them and they're calling. So although there was no females, it was sort of just a really nice feeling, a really nice sort of thing to hear that, you know, all this work you're doing. So it was a great start. And then, as I said, Melbourne Zoo now have bred them. So, you know, that's awesome. And then we've got the alpine tree frog. So this is a slightly different species, it's a subspecies of the whistling tree frog. And in 2014, December, I went out to find some of these guys and catch some to take back to the ARC. And you can clearly see here, so this is an alpine tree frog, and this is a crinia, it's a putrid carrier. And so it's quite easy to see how putrid is spread. Obviously, it can get spread other ways, but yeah, if you've got a pretty grasping on your back, you sort of, you've got putrid, you're probably going to get stuck with it. So I still remember bush bashing to this site. It took, I think, a couple of hours to sort of walk in there, and it's just like no one's been here. You feel like you're in a place that no one's been. It's completely untouched, and yet you've got these frogs defining, which is, you know, not a great feeling. So these guys are really interesting, though. They've sort of seemed to deal with putrid in some populations in a slightly different way. Some of the populations that have been studied, they've only found, I believe, 5 or 6 year old frogs. Everything older than that is dying, has died. They're also breeding a lot faster and a lot younger than they were historically known to. So they're sort of dealing with putrid in a way that, obviously, the longer it takes you to breed and the longer you live, the more likely you're going to come into get putrid. So it's really great that we've sort of found that out, that they're dealing with putrid and sort of being able to breed that. However, it's worried that the genetic variation in the population is quite low. So if another strain came or something else came along, they sort of may have issues. So that's the alpine bog there that we were finding the alpine tree frogs. So throughout the 7 years at the ARC, I got to work with about 50 species of frogs. This is me, James, and you pretending I know what I'm doing in front of a microscope, because I'm never in front of a microscope. This is the Amphibian Disease Conference at JCU in Townsville. So that was awesome to be able to go to. That was when we just started working at ARC. I also got to go to Japan for a genetic modification conference. I saw a giant salamander in the wild, like this big, like just blows your mind. And there's some eggs. So that was awesome. And then I was in a meeting at Rankin's when a review of the conservation of frogs throughout Australia was done. And somehow, I don't know how, they included me on the paper. I certainly didn't put my hand up and raise any serious points, but so that's the priorities of management of putrid mycosis in Australia, certainly from frogs from extinction. And oops, I don't know, I messed up. Well, there we go. You put the photo up, and I'm like, oh, I want that photo, thank you very much. So that was awesome. So now I'm the senior keeper at Melbourne Museum. I'm not really dealing directly with frog conservation, but we've got a few frogs, so we bred the ground grass frogs and we raised them outside in big, basically big board barrels. They've got these awesome bright green minerals coming through, so that was cool. And we've got some heterozygote polywogs, so we've got all these gorgeous mixed coloured albino polywogs. double box, so it's a pretty cool thing to have. And then I also holiday and find frogs. So both in Australia and overseas, so that's me and Vietnam.